I was in Boise, Idaho, working for the American Civil Liberties Union, the same people who tried to pass that gay bashing constitutional amendment in Oregon that was defeated, tried to do the same thing on the ballot in Idaho during the last election. So the ACLU is a very conservative state, needed, you know, some help from a lot of people in order to bring that to the public's attention. They put me up at a crumbling Victorian pile that purported to be a hotel. I got up in the morning early. I went out to get a newspaper. I walked up the street to the newsstand, and a young fellow stepped out of a doorway and said, "Hey, man, you got any spare change?" That's happened to you. Some of you have probably done it. Well, I said, no. It's not that I'm an ungenerous soul. I fling money about with abandon when I've got it. What I said was, look, I'll stand right here, and I want you to go away and find a burlap bag or a pillowcase, put a rock in it, and then put it over your shoulder, come back and stand in front of me and say, excuse me, but I've got a chicken in this bag. I'm going to go onto the edge of town and cook it up. But I don't have any salt. Could you spare some change for some salt? Do you get the difference? I said, I want you to gaff me. What's a gaff? Well, a gaff is a hook. How does a fisherman bring in the fish? Well, he uses a gaffing hook. What's the fish? Well, that's your mark. How do you hook the mark? You know, are you following me here? How do you gaff the rubes when you're piping the stem? Well, you use a gaffing hook. You know, use a gaff. Everybody's got a gaff. Teachers got a gaff. Preachers, lawyers, God knows, got a gaff. I've got a gaff. I'm doing it right now. Where is that? Hey, man, got any spare change? Where's that at? I want to grab the spare change artist and rattle him and say, where's your sense of drama? Where's your sense of the theater of your situation? All the things you could do with this. I learned from gaffing artists, the best and the brightest, the most beautiful in the human psyche is that propensity for walking off of something with little or no effort. The rich have long since learned how to do it. Why shouldn't we? I mean, and it is. It blossoms around us. I was an African-American fella on the Haight in Berkeley. Walked up to me with a styrofoam cup, a little sign around his neck. It said, give to the United Negro Hamburger Fund. Well, hell, it's good for a couple dollars right there. A couple bucks. I mean, wouldn't you? Hell yeah. Ironclad gap. Fella standing on the median strip in Cambridge, Massachusetts. I had to stop to wait for the light to change. He was standing there in rags with a hand-lettered cardboard sign folded in half. The top half said, what is the greatest nation on earth? Got my attention. He let the other half flop down. It said, donation. And that's pretty damn bright. You know, there's another couple of bucks right out the window. You know, I will pay for a good gaff. I will pay for a solid story. We should be teaching this stuff in school. I should come to your college here and do a workshop. We're all going to have to know this stuff the way things are going. Huh? All going to have to know it. I could do a crackerjack class on how to get through the world on little or nothing. Gaffing your way down the road. Hot dog. Ironclad gaff. Donna Devine, up in Butte, Montana, works at the Copper King. She's a waitress, doesn't make a lot of money. Fellow worker Devine, she's a member of the Industrial Workers of the World. Donna wanted to go to a wedding in Florida. Had maybe enough money for gas for her old car. She started out in the dead of winter across the belly of the continent. Mainly at midnight, hopefully in the rain or the snow. She stopped at run-down, greasy truck stops. She would take a dimly lit booth in the back of the restaurant, sit there alone, reach into her purse and take out a cupcake, put it on the table in front of her, put a candle in that cupcake and light it, and softly sing happy birthday to herself. Broke those truckers' hearts. Broke their hearts. She didn't pay for anything going or coming. It was that's America. That's my America. That's the America I love. Don't ever change. God. I learned my gaffing from slow motion Shorty. Slow motion Shorty, we'd get off of the freight train coming down out of the Moffat Tunnel out of Grand Junction, Colorado, headed for Denver. Slow motion Shorty was an older guy. So the minute he got off the freight train, he'd head for the parking lot of a supermarket. He'd wait for some couple to come out with a little kid in between them, and, you know, in tow. And he'd kneel down in front of them so they couldn't move any further, and quickly he'd reach into his pocket, take out some of those long balloons you make into balloon animals. He'd stretch them, blow them up, and wrench them together into the rough semblance of a small puppy. He wasn't any good at it. And the kid would reach for it and say, "This puppy costs a dollar. Go ask your old man for a dollar." Well, the kid's over there whimpering, tugging on his old man's pants, and while he's gone, slow motion takes a pocket knife out, opens it up, holds the blade up to the balloon. Yeah, he said, "You wouldn't want me to kill the puppy in front of the little kid, would you?" Money just poured in. I don't lie about this stuff. Now, you got to learn this. One more. What's his name? Dawdlin Bill, the world's slowest human, Dawdlin Bill. Up out back of the Speedway Diner in Forsyth, Montana, jungled up with him many a good time. The Speedway Diner, I don't know if it's still there, 6 stools, run-down, ramshackle, place you drive by, except they cut their own bacon, have their own chicken, so it's fresh eggs, they bake their own bread, everything's fresh and new. Well, Dodd and Bill have been back out there when he's not on the trains for many years, and he is the world's slowest human. He said to me once, "I was born with a finite amount of hurrying power. If I squander it fruitlessly dashing about, a dire event is going to transpire, but I won't be able to get out of the way because I have exhausted my hurrying power. But if I hoard it and that event transpires, I will unleash it all at once, and you will see me move like a rocket." The most exhaustive rationalization for being lazy I ever read. Suits me fine. I saw Dodd and Bill make $30 an hour gaffing on the streets of Spokane, Washington, East Main and Trent Avenue. He'd walk, fall in step with people walking by there. He'd walk with them. He'd say, "Well, you know, I used to be a magician, sleight of hand artist. I was good at it. But arthritis and age, too much booze and late hours, and nobody wants a magician anymore anyway. I used to be able to take a dollar bill and roll it up real tight and jam it up one side of my nose and pull it out the other. It's a cheap trick." Well, 3 out of 5 people would fall for it. He'd take the dollar bill and roll it up real tight and push it into his nose and then take it out and say, "Well, I guess I forgot how to do it," and try to hand it back. You can do that downtown tonight. You can go down there and do that tonight. You'd be a whole lot better off tomorrow. Think about it. My first tramps were in Dayton, Ohio. My father was stationed there during the Second World War in the Army Air Corps. Of course, those days, toward the end of the war, President Truman nationalized the railroad. That meant that the yard bulls were gone and the National Guard was in the yards, and the yards got hot. That's when the old tramps settled out. The age of the great tramps in this country was from the American Railway Union strike, 1893, the Pullman strike, Eugene Debs. And that's when so many were blacklisted that all they could do was get on the freight trains and ride. Up to when Truman nationalized the railroad. That's the age of the great tramps. The old ones settled out and built little shanties out of railroad ties along the aprons, along the Nickel Plate Railroad there in Dayton. We would sneak food from the Victory Gardens, kohlrabi and Swiss chard, and other snore food I couldn't stand. and trade it to the tramps for songs and stories and poems and little boxes that they had shipped out of crate boxwood, with neat little drawers in them. I first learned this poem from a tramp named Beard down there when I was 12 years old. In the Dodge City yards of the Santa Fe stood a freight made up for the East. The engineer with his oil and waste was grooming the great iron beast. 10 cars back in the murky dusk, a boxcar door swung wide. The hobo helped his pal on board to start on his last long ride. The lantern swung, the train bowled out, the engine gathered speed. The engineer threw the throttle wide, locked to his fiery steed. 10 cars back in the empty box, the hobo rolled a pill. The flare of the match showed his partner's face, dark white and deathly still. As the train wheels clicked on the coupling joints, a song for the rambler's ear, the hobo talked to the still white form, his pal for many a year. It's a mighty long time we've rambled, Jack, with the luck of men who roam. Back doorsteps for a dining room and a boxcar for a home. We rambled out on the eastern route, the Tops and the Chesapeake. We rode the Leadville Narrow Gauge in the days of old Cripple Creek. We rambled out through sunny Cal on the rails of the old SP, and of all you had through good and bad, well, a half belonged to me. You made me promise to you, pal, if I lived and you cashed in, to take you back to the old churchyard and bury you there with your kin. Well, you must have known that I'd keep my word, because you said I was all right. I'm keeping my promise to you, pal. I'm taking you home tonight. I didn't have no money to send you back. I'm taking you home on the fly. It's a decent way for a beau to go, home to the by and by. As the train rolled over its ribbons of steel straight through to the east it sped, the engineer in his high-capped seat kept his eyes on the rails ahead. 10 cars back in the empty box, the lonely hobo sighed. For the days of old, his pal so cold, a-taking his last long ride.